instrument, singing like that. God, we come together to praise God and to let Him know how thankful we are for Him allowing us to be His children. So this is Praise Central. We come to get our praise on. We invite you this morning to the book of Acts. The chapter is 15. Acts chapter 15. You get there, smile and say,
amen.
If you'll meet me at verse 28. The Bible says, for it seemed good to the Holy Ghost and to us to lay upon you no greater burden than these necessary things, that you abstain from meats offered to idols, and from blood, and from things strangled, and from fornication, from which if you keep yourselves, you shall do well. Fare you well. So when they were dismissed, they came to Antioch, and when they had gathered the multitude together, they delivered the epistle, which when they had read, they rejoiced for the consolation. And Judas and Silas, being prophets also themselves, exhorted the brethren with many words and confirmed them. From this passage of scripture this morning, the message is entitled, You Have a Right to Remain Silent. You have a right to remain silent. Beloved, this particular chapter in the Bible deals with some trouble in the church. And the Jerusalem Council had been assembled to address the trouble in the early church. What was the issue was the fact that there were some who were preaching false doctrine. There were some who were trying to enforce tradition. And these misguided teachers created controversy, confusion, and chaos in the church. Somebody said something that really should have never been said. Just because you have an opinion doesn't mean you need to share it. And the opinion that was given was one in which the racial undertones of the first century became abundantly clear to those in the early church. Because the early church had with it the inclusion of the Gentiles. And there were some Jewish traditionalists who were not really happy and ecstatic or excited by the idea that God had in His plan of salvation inclusion of the Gentiles. And so what these Jewish traditionalists tried to do was to enforce upon the Gentiles the concept of circumcision. And what that teaches us is that people believe that where they are is where you ought to be. That the things that they conform to, they believe you ought to conform to. The traditions and the things that they have accepted as norms, they just believe that unless you see things the way they see things, something's wrong with you. Instead of being open-minded and embracing something different, something new, and certainly something that was in God's plans, they felt as if everyone ought to think the same thing and think the same way about what it is they were thinking about. And one of the problems that we so often encounter is that for different reasons, people have different perspectives and see things differently. And the problem comes in when someone tries to make binding on you something that they hold as a personal value. There are some things that are a matter of law where we all are supposed to agree. But then there are some things that are a matter of liberty. In other words, we might have a different perspective, a different angle, or be coming from different places, but it's all right, and it doesn't mean we can't be together if we might see some things that are liberty issues differently. But what happens is that people try to enforce liberty on somebody else. And the way they see it is the way you ought to see it. And they will go to their grave trying to convince you that their perspective is right, not understanding they have a right to an opinion, but they also have a right to remain silent.
Yeah. How many times do people fall out about opinions? How many times are good relationships destroyed over perspectives? How many times do people say something that they feel they need to say, that they've got to get off their chest, they've got the right to say, not understanding that God has allowed us the ability of choice, and because we come from different perspectives, we ain't gonna all see everything the same way. I want you to walk with me through this chapter of the Bible and look at the issue and what it is the Jerusalem Council had to address. The first thing that they had to deal with was the contamination in the church. When something is contaminated, it's polluted. And one of the pollutants in the church were the words that were spoken. Now, these are some Gentile new converts who are excited about being in Jesus. And somebody comes along and says something that undermines their joy and their excitement about being in the body of Christ. Now, one of the problems, not only in the first century church, but even in the church today, is that you have to contend with the unidentified few who act as if they're speaking for the masses. Look at verse number 1. The Bible says in Acts chapter 15, in verse number 1, and certain men. Is that in your Bible? Now we sometimes say they. We say they are some. We say a certain few. But these are the unidentified people who trouble the masses. They claim to know what's best for everybody. They speak the loudest. They talk more than they listen. And they trouble the Gentile converts because of their traditional views of the Mosaic Law. They called themselves so holy and so religious. They did not understand that in their holiness, in their quest for being religious, that God had dealt with the law of Moses, and that the people of God, inclusive of the Gentiles, were now living under grace and truth. Now, what we have to recognize about people and their influences is that when people have a norm or a standard, sometimes their ability to get along with someone else is determined by whether or not they can get you to conform to what it is they conform with. That they want you to accept what they have accepted. That their standards have to be your standards. And people want to define you by their own perceptions of themselves. If they see themselves as a certain way, you have to be just like them.
not understanding that the real standard is us being like Jesus.
I want you to notice something, if you will. Turn with me to the book of Numbers, chapter 13. Have you ever noticed that when a point is to be made, people will speak for you, even though you didn't ask them to speak for you? See, I believe that all of us have a right to a perspective, which means you don't have to include someone else for your perspective to be respected. And what we discover in Numbers chapter 13 is that there were some spies who were sent out to the land. And instead of saying, "This is how I see myself," the spies said, "Well, this is how I see us." Notice in these spies, in Numbers chapter 13, 12 were sent out. Two came back with a good report. That lets me know that democracy is not always right, that the majority is not always right. Because the majority, the 10, came back with a negative report. And just because the majority spoke, that means that the majority was right. But this majority, this group of spies in chapter 13 of the book of Numbers, starting verse 31, the Bible says, "But the men that went up with him said, 'We be not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we.'" Now, I don't know about you, but I see some problems right there in verse number 31. These spies assumed that because they were weak, that everybody else in the group had to be weak. They had a grasshopper complex. They felt inadequate. They felt weak. They felt negative. They felt inferior. And instead of coming back and saying, "I feel negative," instead of saying, "I feel weak," or "I feel inadequate," or "I feel inferior," they tried to soften the reality by saying, "Well, we can't do it. We are not strong. We are not weak. We are inadequate." The way they saw themselves is the way they saw the rest of the group. And they brought up an evil report of the land which they had searched unto the children, which they had searched unto the children of Israel, saying, "The land through which we have gone to search it is a land that eateth up the inhabitants thereof, and all the people that we saw in it are men of great stature. And there we saw the giants, the son of Anak, which come of the giants, and we are in our own sight as grasshoppers." So you have to be careful about being around people who feel inadequate. Because if you're not careful, they'll try to cast inadequacy on you. You have to be careful about being around people who don't have confidence in themselves, who always find something wrong with life, ain't never got anything good to talk about, always got a complaint, ain't never got a testimony. If you're not careful, folk can rub off on you. Not only do people like to rub off on you, you have to recognize that sometimes when you are positive, a negative person can't stand you being positive. If you happy and they ain't happy, they wonder what you got to be so happy about. You see some people, you say, "Good Lord, what's so good about it? I mean, got an attitude about everything. Can find the problem in every situation," not recognizing when those spies went out to see the land, the real issue wasn't what they could do, the issue was what can God do. Anytime we trust in ourselves, we are always going to be inadequate, inferior, negative, and weak. But when we have, like Joshua and Caleb, another spirit in us, and we trust in the power of God, there is no task too hard, there is no burden that we can't bear, there's no situation, no circumstance, there is nothing that God can't see us through. Amen. Negative people
people have the right to just keep on being silent. You look at Acts chapter 15, the way that this contamination to the early church was addressed is that the Jerusalem Council was assembled, and the conclusion was to send some consolation to the church. Y'all think the church ever needs some consoling? In verses 28 through 31, the Bible makes it clear that the apostles, the elders, and all the brethren, they determined that these Gentiles had upset the church. And so they said, we're going to do two things to encourage the people of God. The first thing we're going to do is send some representatives who can go and share a word of consolation. The second thing they said is we're going to send a letter that will ease the troubled minds of the people of God. And so as a result of sending the representatives and sending the letter, the Bible talks about the fact that the church received some consolation. Now, in looking at this, there were two issues that the apostles and the elders and the brethren were trying to get beyond. If you look at verse number 24, one of the things that they have to deal with is the concept of subverting the souls. Verse 24 says, for as much as we have heard that certain which went out from us troubled you with words, subverting your souls. If you look at the word subvert, it has two meanings. Number one, subvert means to overthrow from a foundation. Secondly, it means to corrupt something that was once pure. So when we go back to verse number one, and these certain men were talking the talk that shouldn't have been talked when they were doing the talk that they were doing, they should have kept silent, because what they said did nothing to bless the people of God. They did nothing to help the people of God. Trying to bring this contaminating doctrine to the people of God, all that had the potential to do was to overthrow the faith foundation of the early church and to corrupt the people of God with nonsense.
You got to be careful of the stuff you take in. You got to be careful who you talk to and who you listen to. Because some folk will subvert, they will overthrow, they will corrupt you with negativity. But then in verse number 28, he also talks about not only the idea of subverting the soul, but he said that what they are teaching you, it is a weight, a burden for you to carry. Look at verse number 28. For it seemed good to the Holy Spirit to us to lay upon you no greater what? Burden. Don't you recognize that when you have a burden is a crushing weight that will exhaust you and destroy you. It will ultimately kill you if you are dealing with the burden by yourself. And what they said in sending these representatives is that you have been emancipated. You have been made free from traditional thinking. You have been made free from this subverting thought. You are free. You can think beyond this tradition. You now have the freedom to go about your business of being a child of God. Now, you have to understand, people have a tendency to think in silos, think a certain way, they see life a certain way, they see things a certain way. Some folk have no peripheral vision in their thinking. I'm not talking about their eyesight, I'm not talking about the physical ability to see, I'm saying that there are times that people can't see beyond a silo. Can't see beyond the way they've always seen it, they've always said it, they've always done it.
And when you think in terms of silos, the problem is that you don't get any further in life than how you think. And so if your thinking is corrupted, the outcomes of your life become corrupt. We have to expand our minds and embrace knowledge, embrace information, surround ourselves with people who can contribute healthy things to us, challenge ourselves to look at the same thing differently, and to recognize that a different outcome comes from a different input. You cannot continue doing the same thing the same way and hope you're going to get the same, a different thing. If you take, for example, some of us have set goals and resolutions, and I don't have a problem with a person having a resolution, but if you did not meet a standard last year and you set the same standard this year, but you don't change your behavior, and you do exactly this year what you did last year, I guarantee you, you're going to get the same result. In order to get something different, you have to think beyond the way you've always been thinking. Now, one of the things that we do is that we blame a lot of stuff on God, and we need to apologize to God. Because many times we get outcomes, and the conclusion is that must have been God's will. I'm going to tell you, don't believe me, we can talk after church. Everything that happens is not God's will. Everything that happens is not God's will. Now, God knows things will happen, but the fact that he knows it will happen doesn't mean that he makes it happen. Well, Brother Gibbs, what do you mean it's not God's will, everything that happens? Here's what we have to rest on, is God made us creatures of choice. And we make choices. And choices have outcomes. Now, when you make a bad choice, and you get an undesired outcome, you can't blame that on God and say, well, this must have been God's will. No, that was your will. That was your choice. There are things that God gives us the right to choose. And so what we have to do is, when we make bad choices, is learn to forgive ourselves. But in forgiving ourselves, we've got to own the choice in the first place. Instead of saying, well, God must have meant for this to happen. No, you meant for this to happen. Amen. You recognize that in life, God does not beat us over the head and make us do anything. We choose to obey or disobey God. One of the last words that Moses had with Israel is that Moses put before them both good and bad. And he says, now if you do good, this is what's going to happen. You're going to go into the land that flows with milk and honey. You will subdue your enemies. The land will produce. You will prosper. You will inhabit the area. It will be yours. And all of the world will know that God has blessed you, that God has given you the victory. He says, but if you disobey God, when you get to the land, your enemies will take you captive. If you disobey God, the land will not produce. If you disobey God, when you get over there, the honeymoon is going to be over, and things are not going to be as grand, as glorious as they could have been simply because of disobedience. Now, when we look at the fact that Israel was taken captive, the land did not produce, they dealt with famine and destruction, and their enemies would come and beat up on them and take advantage of them, we can't say, well, that was God's will. That was their choice. And choices bring consequences. So they sent these brethren to console them and to let them know that your choices don't have to be defined by somebody else's choice for you, that God has given you the liberty. Finally, the Bible says that from contamination and consolation, there was a confirmation. In verse number 32, the Bible says, and Judas and Silas, being prophets, also themselves exhorted the brethren with many words, and confirm thee. Is that in your Bibles? Look at this text. You would think that the fact that the Jerusalem Council sent a letter of consolation, the fact that the Jerusalem Council sent men to represent them, that the issue would have been resolved. And yet in verse number 32, it says, after they dealt with being consoled, that they were further confirmed. Now, you would think that the letter was enough. You would think that the words of the representatives was enough. But this word confirmed, if you study it, it has a meaning which says to go further and to reinforce an idea and to provide support for an original idea. So what happens is that the Jerusalem Council sent people and a letter to confirm them. But in verse number 32, Judas and Silas said, we want to go even further. And we want to share some words with you that will reinforce you and go further in supporting you and encouraging you and strengthening you and building you up. In other words, the people of God, we can never think that we've done enough to be encouraged. Discouragement tends to be deep. Discouragement is serious. Discouragement is rooted and embedded within the fiber of our being. And so when we understand confirmation, it has much value to us because sometimes a letter just ain't good enough. Sometimes a couple of representatives just ain't good enough, because as soon as you stop reading the letter, as soon as the representatives leave, sometimes you find that despair and loneliness and frustration will meet you in the middle of the night. Have you ever dealt with something? For example, I've often shared the idea with people that when someone has a death in the family, they are bombarded with phone calls, letters, and support. People have put $20 in your hand. You go to the mailbox, somebody sent a sympathy card. You get home, there are 10 messages waiting, offering condolences. You go to the funeral, there are people surrounding you with support. And we sometimes unintentionally forget that when that week is over with, when the cards stop coming, when people stop dropping food off, when they stop putting $20 in your hand, when the phone call ceases, when the postman no longer has a card for you, people are still dealing with the grief. Now, we have gone on about our business. We have stopped caring, or at least being attentive. But it doesn't mean that the week that they suffered the loss, that we did enough to minister to them. Sometimes we need to make a phone call a month later, 6 months later. We need to be thinking about it, holidays and anniversaries and birthdays, about how the pain sets in again and they are reminded of the loss of the loved one, and to say, maybe I need to call sister so-and-so or brother so-and-so and invite them out to a meal, or put a card in the mail, or put $10 in their hand. Because just because I'm finished with your grief doesn't mean you're finished with your grief. And a part of us serving one another is to be compassionate and sensitive to the fact that sometimes it's easy to get in controversy and chaos and confusion. It's easy to encounter situations that hurt you, but one card doesn't deal with my grief. One phone call didn't stop my pain. So when we talk about this idea of them, Judas and Silas, confirming them, Judas and Silas is saying, yes, you got the letter from the Jerusalem Council. You saw us as representatives, but we want to stick around a little bit and say some things to you and bless you and deposit something in your spirit. When we courage, think about it like a bank account. Encourage means to deposit some courage. Where are you depositing the courage? You're depositing it in the spirit of the person. Now you think about the fact that many people have had a lot of discouraging checks written. And sometimes we need to put some courage in the bank account. So the next time they encounter a courage situation, they can write a check and it don't bounce. Amen, somebody. That's what it means to think about people. Now, the very same thing that was done to hurt the people is what Judas and Silas did to help them. You remember in verse number 1, certain men said something that discouraged them. Now, I want you to notice verse number 32. Judas and Silas, being prophets also themselves. In other words, what they said, they got it directly from God. See, if somebody going to talk to you, you need to make sure they can talk to God. Better yet, you need to make sure God can talk to them and they can listen. Because everybody can't go about encouraging everybody. Sometimes folks say some stuff and they don't mean no harm, but they do everything they can to try to encourage you. And you be around some folks and say, Lord, have mercy. I want to encourage them. Now I'm the bricks. I be around folks like that. You go trying to cheer them up. And you go, and you got to be careful about being around just any kind of person. But these people, they got theirs directly from God. Now look at verse number 32. Being prophets, exhorted the brethren with many words. Is that in your Bible? They were hurt by a few words. And so Judas and Silas said, if you were hurt by words, we're going to stick around and exhort you with many words. Don't you know some folks just need to hear something good? Every now and then you need to run across somebody that can deposit a little love in your life and say something good, that when you're ready to wave the white flag of surrender, when you're ready to give up, it's good to just look around you and find somebody that's got something good to say. And even if you can't understand what I'm going through and what I'm dealing with, just knowing that you care sometimes can help you to deal with some mountains. One of the hardest things in life is to face a trial or tribulation by yourself. Folks are busy, too much to do, ain't got time for you. When stuff is good, when stuff is going great in your life, you don't find it hard to have an entourage. But have to deal with the burdens of life by yourself. Having to face the giants of life by yourself. Having to cry by yourself. Having to deal with depression. You'll find you'll be by yourself. The Bible says, rejoice with them that rejoice.
Right.
It also says, weep with them that weep. I want you to look at two scriptures with me as we prepare to close. Look at Romans 15. To think about what we say. Sometimes we don't need to say anything. If we're going to be like those men in verse number 1 and discouraged, sometimes we just need to know we have a right to remain silent. But if you want to say something, the Bible gives us the parameters to determine if we need to say what needs to be said. Romans chapter 15. I want you to look at verse number 2. The Bible says, let every one of us please his neighbor for his good to edification. What would our lives be like if we were surrounded by people who were trying to build us up? Now, I know we got plenty of folk in our lives that will tear us down. You know, you can try to accomplish anything in life and you be so glad about what God is doing in your life, and somebody will try to make you feel bad. You think you all are bad and you change and, you know, you ain't keeping it real and why you move out the hood and I remember when you used to be like one of us. You know, folk want you to feel bad because God has blessed you. that you're doing good is because your doing good reflects to them that they're doing bad. And instead of them learning from you how you got out the hood, or how you're able to do the things that you're able to do by the grace of God, they want to bring you back down so that they don't feel the pressure to rise to the top.
Some folks, you just gotta leave alone. For your own good and for their own good.
But our job is to be able to edify each other, to build each other up. So when we gather together, we ought not just be thinking about what the preacher's going to preach or who's going to be leading songs or what's going to be said in prayer. Our mindset should be, I am going to see the saints. What can I do today to build up somebody?
Now, remember, you reap what you sow. If you ain't sowing edification, encouragement, exhortation, you got to remember your day is coming. And you don't determine your appetite at harvest time. You determine your appetite at seed time. See, when you go out to the harvest, and at the harvest you see watermelon, and you say, well, I don't want watermelon, I want oranges. That's the wrong time to determine what you want to eat. You determine at seed time what I think I'm going to want at harvest time. Because seed time is when I'm planting. Seed time is when I'm anticipating. Seed time is when I'm using my forethought and foresight. And so I need to think ahead and say, when this crop comes back to me, what do I want at that time? Yes. So if you think about encouraging, exhorting, edifying people, sow those seeds today. Amen. So that when your harvest comes, you don't have to look for something you may plant. Amen. See, sometimes we're looking for something, we gone and we done planted watermelon and we getting upset we can't find oranges. You ain't planted that. Think about how many folk have you encouraged, how many folk have you edified, how many folk have you exhorted, how many folk have you built up. And when your day comes, then you can look around and have some expectation. Now, let me help you with seed time and harvest. The Bible tells us you reap what you sow. But I need us to recognize two things about reaping and sowing. Y'all got time?
Yes.
Number one, the Bible does not say that you reap where you sow. Y'all need to get this. Sometimes God has a harvest for us over yonder. And because we're looking for it over here, we miss the blessing. In other words, you can look back in your life at people you bless, and you can have the expectation that those same people will bless you. And then we get mad because we're not reaping where we sow. For example, somebody needs some money.
Money make us fall out before, won't it? When you're redefining a relationship over some money. That's why I don't loan money. If I can joke you, I'll bless you and give it to you, but I don't loan nobody money. And if I ain't willing to just be done with it and lose it and forget about it, you ain't going to be. Amen. But if you need $20, if I feel like I can bless you with $20, it's yours. See, I don't want to see you with a new suit. Now I got an attitude. I don't want you to meet me at the bank of relatives. We going out eating. I know you owe me some money. So if I give it to you, I'm just going to bless you and be done with it. Now, what happens is that the day comes, you need $20. And we get an attitude because we say, when so-and-so needed some money, I was there for them. They got a boatload of money and they won't bless me with it. Now, somebody else can give it to you. And instead of you appreciating the blessing, you still got your lip poked out. Because somebody you didn't help didn't return the favor. God says you reap what you sow, but it never say you reap where you sow. Now, you'll get it back. It might come from a different direction, but you'll get it back.
The other thing about reaping and sowing is to understand that you don't always reap when you sow. Just some stuff, good or bad, will come back years later. And see, sometimes when it comes to the bad stuff, folks so forget the stuff they have done to somebody else. But when it comes back, then they say, well, I'm a good person. I can't believe this is happening to me. But they forget about what they have done somewhere else. So you might have a forgettery. But the Lord's got a memory. God once sent the director to go and kill some folk. I remember I had a friend call me at work one day and said, Brother Gibbs, I got into an argument with somebody on my job. They told me something that I said ain't in the Bible. They argued me down. It is. They just couldn't remember where it is. And I want to know from you if they're right or if I'm right. And I said, well, what's the question? Well, they said God once told somebody to go kill women and children. And I said God would have never said such a thing. Ain't I right, Brother Gibbs? I said, you're absolutely wrong. And the reason you're wrong is because God told Saul. He says, I remember what the children of Israel had to go through. I remember how the Amalekites lie and wait for them. I remember about the trickery and deception in the wilderness and how they set snares and traps for my people. He says, Saul, I want you to go and I want to utterly destroy all of the Amalekites because I remember what they did to my people. Right. Right. So that let me know I ain't got to worry about trying to get nobody back. Because God's got to remember. But at the same time, it causes me to examine my behavior. Because just like God can remember what the Amalekites did, God can remember what I did. And I don't want to be standing there when he gets the Amalekites of my life back saying, now take that and give them, Lord, because my day might be coming. If I ain't careful, I have to be very careful about being so full of pride and arrogance. To think that there's so much mercy for me and so much justice for everybody else. People need encouragement. People need to be built up. I want you to remember these two dates as we close. February 24th, 1791, and March 2nd, 1791. February 24th, 1791, and March 2nd, 1791. There was a guy by the name of William Wilberforce. You've heard of him. Mr. Wilberforce. One of the things, young people, you need to understand is that slavery didn't just exist in America. In the British Empire, they struggled with the concept of slavery. And there was a man by the name of William Wilberforce who was a politician. He worked in Parliament. And he tried to get the British Empire to get rid of slavery. And in 1791, February 24th, his minister, John Wesley, wrote him a very short note that says, go on in the name of God and in the power of
1791. Just a few days later, March 7th, 1791, John Wesley died. That is the last known letter John Wesley wrote was to William Wilberforce to go on in the name of God and in the power of his might. And a few days later, he died. A few years afterwards, William Wilberforce put forward the idea again in Parliament to abolish slavery. And Parliament voted no to get rid of slavery. And William Wilberforce went home and told his wife that he was no longer going to crusade against the fight to end slavery. And he was laying in his bed, opened his Bible, and his note from 1791 fell out of his Bible and reminded him of the words of John Wesley that says, "Go on in the name of God and in the power of his might." Those few encouraging words changed his mind. And he, instead of giving up the fight, continued to crusade for the end of slavery. Now, this note was written in 1791. It was not until 1833 that slavery ended in Britain. Here's the moral of the story. The person who was crusading against slavery got discouraged. But somebody had said something to encourage him right before he died. Sent a note of encouragement that caused this man to work another 30, 40 years. The power of encouragement sometimes is just saying the small things that give somebody who's ready to give up the hope and the encouragement to keep on keeping. You have to ask yourself, what would have happened if John Wesley had never seen the note, or written the note? What would have happened if he did not remind himself of what his friend had once told him? A little encouragement goes along the way. Just like a few words can hurt, a few words can heal. And so I want to appeal to us to, if we don't have something good to say that edifies someone, that builds someone up, we got a right to remain silent. If we got a bunch of opinions and we stuck in the way we see something and we feel the way we feel, keep it to ourselves. But if we can say something that will minister to somebody, that will edify somebody, that will exhort somebody, that will help somebody to have a little bit of courage, you might make the difference. And whether somebody gives up, or like William Wilberforce, they keep on trying and keep on keeping on. People today, especially the people of God, we need to be reminded to persevere. We need to be reminded. And you don't have to have a PhD in counseling to help somebody. You know what counselors do? They charge you $100 an hour to lay on their couch. They go lay on somebody else's couch. They got the same problems you got. And all a counselor really does is listen to you. It kind of facilitates and maybe kind of guide you in some things. But the greatest counsel we need is who can use some encouragement? We all could stand some consolation and some confirmation, because in our lives we done dealt with some contamination. Amen. I do believe that if we have the mindset that when we come together, it is not only to worship, but a part of our fellowship is building each other up. I cannot promise you that when you leave here that your problems are going to be gone when you get home. I know we see on television that these so-called prophetic preachers tell you to come up front and they blow on you and you fall back and they put a sheet on you and, you know, all that kind of stuff, and they speak some that stuff in the name of Jesus and they bind up Satan, as they say, and they stomping all over Satan and you're going to be healed and your problems are going to be gone. And they tell you, bring your bills to the church and we're going to throw bills in the bowl and we gonna burn them, and when you get home, you still gonna have them bills. The postman keep on delivering. You still need to go to the doctor. But a little encouragement might not move the mountain, but it'll help you to climb it. Might not change your circumstance, but it'll help you to deal with it. It might not remove the stone, but it can help you to weather. Is that all right? As we prepare to close the message for the day, we certainly bid you to come if you desire prayer for the church. If you need some encouragement, we can pray with you and we can pray for you. Those of you who are not members of the body of Christ, the most encouraging word that I can give to you is that in Acts chapter 15, the whole issue was whether or not God would accept and include in his fellowship those who were deemed by people to be defiled and messed up, the Gentiles. And God has an whosoever will plan of salvation. Doesn't matter what people say about you. You got a vote at Calvary. And to respond to the grace of God, all you've got to do is believe his word, repent of your sins, confess Jesus, and will baptize you, and that puts you into the body of Christ. The beautiful thing about baptism is you become a new creature. No matter what your hang-ups or mess-ups were, your slate will be wiped clean. You will be a new creature in Christ. If you desire to respond, come as we together stand and sing.